As I was saying, thank you very much, everybody, for coming along to this evening's talk, entitled Why Does Schoenberg Sound So Weird? A Beginner's Guide to 20th Century Music. I did think to myself when coming up with this talk that it would be wonderful to be able to cover all 20th century music in an hour, but then I realized actually how naive that was. So this evening, what we're going to be covering is the composer Schoenberg, Arnold Schoenberg, and his legacy. I often find that music of Schoenberg's kind and lots of 20th century music is kind of shoved into concerts, kind of like the approach of, if you have your vegetables, then you can have your ice cream. It's sort of shoved in and nobody really knows why it's there. And so I find that a little bit of a disappointment, because there is so much more to contemporary and modern music. But the problem is actually, how was it composed? Why did Schoenberg compose the way that he did? And more importantly, how did he do it? So the aim of this evening's talk is to give you some pointers and some explanation as to the style that he composed and why he did it. Rest assured that this talk this evening isn't going to turn you into preach of Schoenberg's music. I'd be a little bit worried if everybody went away and started listening to it all the time. But what I do hope is that it gives you some understanding into what Schoenberg did and why he did it. And with that in mind, this evening's talk, I must tell you, does cover some rather heavy topics. So please just bear that in mind. And I might even recommend that you pour yourselves a gin and tonic for this evening if you haven't done already, which brings me on very perfectly to the beginning of this evening's talk, because there is an old music geeky joke, which is that Schoenberg walks into a bar and orders a gin, but asks for without the tonic. Now, although that may make no sense to you at all at this stage, it's kind of a good place for us to start this evening's talk and to figure out as to why that joke, how it makes sense. So here is a very brief beginner's guide to music theory, a very brief idea, and to give you some key ideas and some key terms that we're going to cover through this evening. I've got my piano here, and we're going to cover a couple of these now. Many of these terms you may have come across before, but you may have not figured them out perfectly in your head. A major chord, to start with, is often referred to as a happy chord or a bright chord. A minor chord is often referred to as a sad chord or a gloomy chord. And if you think of one of the most famous pieces by Strauss, at the beginning of that theme that we all know, the first chord is a major chord, and the second chord is a minor chord. Scales is an important term for us to come across, which scales are a sequence of notes which are defined on the note that you start on. So if I'm playing a C to start with, and this is a scale of C major, the next scale that we have to cover is a chromatic scale, which is where all of the notes are as close together as they can be. Note that whilst I play this, I'm playing 12 notes. That's going to come in importance later. So that's all of the notes that we have on the keyboard, and there are 12 of them. Tonality is essentially when music has a fundamental note and which all of the other notes are related to. So a C major is a tonal chord, and it sounds pleasant, quite simply. Whereas, and the tonic of that chord is a C, because it's a C major chord. So going back to that joke of Schoenberg walking into a bar and having a gin without a tonic, if you don't have a tonic in a piece of music, the music can sound all over the place. And of course, it's no good to actually explain a joke. It gives you a nutshell as to what Schoenberg is trying to do in his music. Another term that we're going to come across now is dissonance. And dissonance, quite simply, is when musical pitches or notes clash against each other in terms of how the notes relate to each other. So some dissonance can be quite nice. This technically is a piece of dissonance. So if I start on this chord, you can actually hear that these two notes are clashing against each other. But if I bring them and resolve them, it sounds quite nice and quite pleasant. So that's a really PG version of dissonance. And something even more extreme, that would be another example of dissonance. So I hope that gives you an idea as to what the word dissonance is all about. But as I said, some dissonance can be quite pleasant to listen to. And what was happening at the start of the 20th century, end of the 19th century, was composers were experimenting more and more with dissonance in their music. And dissonance can be used to create a sort of emotional strain, if you will. We're going to have a listen to a couple of examples how that dissonance can actually sound quite nice. The first video that we're going to listen to, about a minute long, is Debussy's L'après-midi d'un faune, which is the afternoon of a faun. One example of some pleasant dissonance, and I hope that everyone could hear that. The next piece that we're going to have a listen to is Mahler's Symphony No. 10, which personally for me is possibly one of my favourite pieces ever. So both of these pieces are right on the edge of our magic words, tonality, and they have a lot of dissonance in them, a lot of clashiness to them, but they're still just on the edge of being, for want of a better word, bearable. They have a home key, which is very important. They have a tonic. They have a sense of where they are in the music, though. So that's very important. When it comes to music history in a nutshell, for the past 250 years before Schoenberg, is that music can be simply constrained or defined as constantly trying to expand its boundaries. That's it in a nutshell. If you think of comparing, let's say, Vivaldi to Mahler as an example, the dynamics, the louds and softs in Vivaldi are barely noticeable compared to Mahler, which are huge. There can be really quiet moments and some very, very loud moments. The orchestration is much, much bigger in the Mahler compared to the Vivaldi, which would generally be much smaller. There's also a lot more emotional contrast. Vivaldi could simply be happy or sad, whereas Mahler could be utterly desolate and absolutely joyful. So all of these things are where we find Schoenberg. And now we have to think about also what is going on in terms of the whole evolution of artistry when we arrive with Schoenberg. Schoenberg's music was, the parts that he's specifically famous for is written during the Expressionist movement. So I've got a lovely Wikipedia definition for us here. Expressionism is a modernist movement initially in poetry and painting, originating in Germany at the beginning of the 20th century. Its typical trait is to present the world solely from a subjective perspective, distorting it radically for emotional effect in order to evoke moods or ideas. I'm sure you can understand now why I told you to get that gin and tonic at the beginning. So expression is certainly all about trying to capture human emotion, and which I personally think the expressionists believe was suffering in the most basic sense. What we have before expressionism often is music being pretty and being enjoyable, and art, all of it being pretty and being enjoyable. But expressionism is about extreme irrational states of mind, and there's no more artisan music, no music for the sake of it being nice to listen to. One of Schoenberg's pupils, Anton Webern, that we're going to talk about later, said or believed that the breakdown of music was inevitable as it evolved. And this is where we meet Schoenberg. Although Schoenberg is known as writing very dissonant, strange music, he did write quite a bit of tonal music. So that's music that has a key or a note that it's all related to. This was particularly inspired by his knowledge of Wagner, Mahler, Strauss, Brahms, all of the great composers that came before him. It's strange also to think that Schoenberg knew an awful lot about tonality, so the nice sounding music, and he even wrote a book on it called The Theory of Harmony, which is very similar to theories that J.S. Bach came to be known for. Bach is often considered as the grandfather of tonal music and Western classical tradition. It's interesting to think that this quote underneath, Schoenberg said, "In higher art, only that is worth being presented, which has never been presented. There is no great work of art which does not convey a new message to humanity. There is also no great artist who fails in this respect. This is the code of honor of all the great in art, and consequently in all great works of the great, we will find that newness which never perishes, whether it be of Josquin des Prez, of Bach, or Haydn, or of any other great master, because art means new art." So although Schoenberg wanted to push music on, and he was very, he really wanted to do that, he was also very aware of what came before him. And so he wanted to move the art form on whilst also respecting it. But why did he want to do that? Because he wanted to create better and greater expression in art. So remembering that the word dissonance means clashy, our clashy chords, it's interesting to think that Schoenberg didn't actually like the use of dissonance in tonal music, which is a very strange thing to think. What he thought was that you should use one or the other. You should be either composing tonal music that all sounded absolutely fine, or you should be writing something completely different. And remember that this is all about his respect for the tradition that he came from. And from that, what he has created comes, what he is famous for, which is the phrase atonality. Now, atonality, as I say, is the main thing that Schoenberg can sometimes be credited for. Now, what is atonality? Well, if tonality sounds nice, quite simply, atonality does not. That's the most simple way of explaining it, but it's something much more complex than that. Why is it so much more complex? That's what we're trying to figure out. And if we can unlock that, it hopefully should give you some more idea as to how to listen to this music. So atonality, it has no hierarchy in pitches used. What does that mean? No one pitch is more important than the other. So if we have our C major chord again, the C is the most important, the middle note is fairly important, and the fifth is fairly important too. That note is going to come nowhere near a chord like that. So the hierarchy in pitches is thrown out the door in atonality. No diatonic nature. What that means is that no one pitch is the home key. That's an extension, essentially, of if this is a C chord, the C is the most important note. We don't have that in atonality. The final point, no preparation or resolution of dissonance. You might remember that we had that chord at the beginning, which was the dissonance being resolved. Now, composing chords like that would be absolutely fine because that is the new system that he's created. What's strange about this definition is that we have lots of no's. We have it's not this, it's not this, and it's not this. And Schoenberg actually said in the quote that I've put underneath, I find above all that the expression atonal music is most unfortunate. It is on a par with calling flying the art of falling or swimming the art of drowning. Essentially, what atonality is that it is freedom. You can compose whatever you want to because it's expressive, because it works, quite simply. So that you always have to bear in mind that when you're listening to Schoenberg, you also have to think about the expressionist movement that he comes from, which is very important. However, with great freedom, it's very difficult to actually compose, because if you can compose anything, well, where on earth do you start? So what we're actually going to do now is we're going to examine some of the techniques that Schoenberg used to create his compositions and to give his music some sort of structure. Schoenberg used, from what I can see, four composition techniques. And we're going to have a look at a couple of those in detail now. The problem with these four techniques is that you can't hear them specifically as you listen to a piece of Schoenberg or a piece of atonal music, but you can just rest assured that they are there. I'm afraid that's the most that you can get. So his first trick is called pitch class sets, and we're going to have a go at this now. What you do to start with is you compose a melody. Let's compose a melody now that we can all remember. Three notes, nice and simple. Once we've composed our three notes, we can transpose them, which means that we put them up a bit. So a transposition might be this. We could invert it, which means that we turn it upside down. So it would normally be like this, but turning it upside down. A retrograde is when you play something backwards. So instead of we play. And what you could do from your melody is that you could also use those three notes to make chords. We have a nice little chord that we all know here. Or I could change the notes, the order of the notes, and put the bottom note on the top, or the other bottom note on the top, and so on and on it goes. How does Schoenberg actually do this in his music? That's the question. We're going to have a look at a specific example here, which is called, the piece is called Saget mir auf welchen Pfaden. I'm going to put the text down here for you in a moment. But to start with, we're just going to analyze a tiny bit of this piece to get it into your head. You'll see that the singer on the top line of music sings this. Those are the first three notes that the singer sings. And what Schoenberg does is that he uses those three notes and he changes them around using the techniques that we've talked about, transposing, inverting, or retrograding. The chord that you might see underneath is made up of those three notes, except transposed and combined a chord together. He also takes that melody and puts it in the bass line in the bottom left hand of the piano. So that would be an example of an inversion, turning it upside down. So there are all these clever little things going on as you listen to Schoenberg. This is the text of this piece that we're going to listen to. You will see that reading it through, it's quite ethereal and evocative, and the tonality or even the atonality that Schoenberg uses in this piece really helps and lends itself to the expression in the text. Let's have a listen to it now. So there's no point in denying that that is very strange music to listen to, but I don't think anyone can deny that the way that Schoenberg writes it in terms of how to express the text works very, very well. The second technique that Schoenberg used is referred to as chromatic saturation. You'll remember at the beginning of the lecture that we talked about the chromatic scale, which has 12 pitches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. All of those 12 pitches can be used within a certain time frame or a certain segment of music. And this is what Schoenberg uses in a couple of his pieces, a lot of his pieces. If you use those, all of those 12 tones within a certain space of time, that's an example of chromatic saturation. Now, you won't have realized this, but in the last piece that we listened to, Zaget Mir, the first two bars actually had all of those 12 tones used within the first two bars. This wasn't exactly a new technique that Schoenberg came up with, because it can actually be used in tonal music, music that has a center. So we're going to have a listen to one of these pieces now. This piece is called Lebe Wohl by Hugo Wolf. And I can't remember when he composed it, but it was at the end of the 19th century, I think. It's certainly tonal and it's certainly pleasant to listen to, but it's very interesting because the first four bars, the composer uses all 12 tones in the first four bars. And he does the same again in bars 5 and 6 without you even realizing it. Let's have a listen.
Oh,
noticed that throughout listening to that music, the tones and the way that the music is written, it's very fluid. And once again, it's expressing the text that you may see. Farewell, it's sad, melancholy music that is that works perfectly with the music. There we go. The next technique that Schoenberg used is possibly the one that you will have heard of the most, 12-tone method. It's essentially the same as the pitch class sets, except instead of using just three, you use all 12 notes of the chromatic scale. And once again, once you've come up with what's known as a tone row, where all of the 12 tones are used, you can transpose them, invert them, or retrograde them. We're going to have a look at another specific example here. Please don't be worried if you can't read this music, because we're going to have a look through it now. At the top of this example, you'll see that it says row forms, and then it says P0. And underneath that is the first line of music, where Schoenberg has arranged all of the 12 tones in an order that he simply wanted to. And it sounds very weird, like this. So there's absolutely no sense of knowing where you are. There's no sense of one note being more important than the other. The line underneath, marked as P6, is where he's moved the whole line up by six notes, hence the word P6, everything up by six notes. Underneath we have I0, which means an inversion. You'll remember that the inversion is turning it upside down. So the P0, the first three notes, sounds like this. But an inversion sounds like this. So you will notice that it's going down in the inversion rather than going up. The I6 on the bottom is where it's the six notes higher, but inverted. I hope you're all keeping up with this. Don't worry, there won't be a test at the end. You may also notice at the far right-hand side of the lines, it says R0, R6, and that is the retrograde, which means that it's played backwards. You may notice that the first four notes of the R0 actually spells out B-A-C-H, which is a reference to J.S. Bach. So what's interesting about that is that all of this music is very much atonal, but it is still written in a style of J.S. Bach. We're going to have a listen to one piece in particular where all of these tone rows are used. You'll notice underneath that there's a diagram that looks very, very confusing, but all it's basically saying is that every single note in this piece is based around these tone rows. It's quite simple as that. How does this music sound though? It sounds very, very strange, but it is all very rationally put together. That's the point to take away from this. It's about a minute long. Hold on. Thank you. expecting any one of you to like that sort of music, but I do hope that you start to appreciate there's a lot of thought and there's a lot of method going into this music. The final technique that Schoenberg came across is less a technique, but it's more something that he did frequently, which is that rather than repeating things, he variated things. So he took something and changed it around, but it's not exactly a repetition. So, as I say, repetition is replacing, is being replaced by variation. And you can see on the bottom, Schoenberg said, "With me, variation almost completely takes the place of repetition." Okay, good news, everybody. That's all of the theory out of the way. That's all of the four things that Schoenberg used. So his, let's see if I can remember them. Pitch class sets, chromatic saturation, 12-tone rows, and non-repetition. So those are all of the techniques that he used. Let's see how he actually used them and why he used them. That's the big question now. One of Schoenberg's most famous pieces is called Pierrot Lunaire, which is a very unusual work. It's essentially Pierrot, his encounter with the moonlight over 21 songs. As you can see, Pierrot is a French theatre or comic opera character, and he's essentially the basis for a clown. Pierrot Lunaire is translated as Moonstruck Pierrot or Pierrot in the Moonlight. We're going to have a look at two of the 21 songs rather than deconstruct the whole thing. Don't worry. The piece in itself, the theme of a clown in the moonlight, opens up to very creepy and mysterious music. So it's a perfect thing that Schoenberg wanted to set. This piece is also very strange because it's a very small ensemble of just five orchestral musicians, three of which play two types of instruments. There's a flute player that also plays a piccolo. There's a clarinet that also plays a bass clarinet. A violin also plays a viola, a cello and a piano. And then a female voice that sings in a style which is called Sprechstimme. It's halfway between singing and speaking, adding to this eerie, strange sound world that Schoenberg creates. The first part of the movement that we're going to have a look at, which is called Nacht, translated as night, is in the style of what's known as a passacaglia. Now, passacaglia is where you have a set bass line upon which variations are placed. Why did Schoenberg use a passacaglia? That's the question. The reason is, for one, that it is an old Western tradition. So he's hearkening once again back to the tradition that he's come from. And also because it gives him a set structure to compose around. How does he do it? And what does the passacaglia sound like? To start with, Schoenberg presents us with just three notes, which sound like this. Already strange and mysterious. Then what he does is that he puts it up, he transposes it, and he creates chords from it. So the beginning sounds something like this. So you can see that he's doing the same thing over and over again, using a set structure, but in a very strange way. We're going to have a listen to the beginning of this now. And what I'd like you to try to do when you listen to this is just to get those three notes in your head, because they form the basis for the whole of the piece. Let's have a listen. It's a very quiet beginning, so you may wish to turn up your sound. very simple, but very effective. What Schoenberg does throughout the whole of this movement is that he takes those three notes and forms a whole piece on them through uses of variations, pitch class sets, chromatic saturation, 12-tone rows, and all of these non-repetitions as well. You won't be able to pick them out as you listen to this, and it's not constructed in that way. So please don't worry if you can't hear it all of the time, but you may notice that that is being passed around through the orchestra. The film that I've chosen out for you is rather spooky, so don't be too, I hope you're enjoying your gin and tonics. It's a rather interesting interpretation of the music as well. And I've put the text on the left-hand side, which I'll just read out for you quickly in case you can't see it. Black gigantic butterflies kill the shining sun. Like a sorcerer's sealed book, the horizon rests in silence. Immediately quite dark. You will notice also that the singer keeps on singing in this style of Sprechstimme, halfway between singing and speaking, that adds to this ghostly effect. See what you think. We're going to have a look at one more movement to let you see that Schoenberg's also able to create other stories through his music in this piece. This movement is called Der Mondfleck, which translates as the moon spot. In this part of the story, a moonbeam lands on Pierrot's coat, which he mistakes as a piece of plaster. And within that, there's a bit of comedy going on. And it's strange to think of this music being comic, but that is what Schoenberg's trying to create. Now, what's rather clever about this piece is that there are some very specific things going on in terms of the techniques that he uses. To start with, what we have is what's known as a canon between the clarinet and the piccolo, which you can see on the two top lines of this score that we've got in front of us. Don't be worried if you can't notice this, but I'm just going to tell you that the clarinet plays a line and two beats later, the piccolo plays exactly the same line. and that canon continues the whole way throughout the piece. That melody can be seen as kind of comical and as though there's something that someone would whistle whilst they're walking down the street, which is what Pierrot is meant to be doing at this point of the show. Underneath, we have the violin and the cello, who play a rhythm which sounds like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, which could be described as someone rubbing their jacket as though trying to get a piece of plaster off their coat, which of course is what exactly happens in the music and in the text. The singer does something completely different, as she always does in this piece. And it's all about reflection of the text. Underneath, we have the clavier or the piano playing pitch class sets, which is where you've got your notes and you've combined them together in chords. And those pitch class sets are based on the clarinet and the piccolo lines. So there's lots of very, very clever stuff going on here, and it's all very methodical. The most impressive part about this whole piece is that when we get to halfway, there's a moment in the text where the text says that Pierrot turns around and has a look at the back of his coat. And as he turns around at that point, the whole of the music is retrograded. So all of the music that happened before the first 10 bars is then played again, but backwards, as though to reflect somebody turning round. So there's lots of methods going on to this. Let's have a listen to this 1 minute piece. Different to the piece that we heard before, than the night compared to the moon spot. And you can see that although they sound extremely strange, they are certainly representative of the text that the composer is trying to set. So Schoenberg is certainly, and there's no two ways about it, naturally inaccessible. But what he did do was that he created freedom in the process of atonality, but he also created some very important structures which composers would later go on to use throughout the 20th century. There are two more composers that I want to cover this evening to give you more of an idea as to how atonality can be used more effectively and more expressively. And we're going to start by having a look at a composer called Alban Berg, who was one of Schoenberg's pupils. Berg wrote some extremely complex works, so not many of them are actually composed by Berg. He didn't write many works. We're going to have a look at a specific example from his opera, Wozzeck. And Wozzeck, the opera, actually took him 8 years to write. This piece often is regarded as one of these pieces that brought atonality to new heights, remembering that the whole point of using atonality is for expressionism. It's trying to push the art and trying to push what art can express, whether you like it or not, quite simply. What he also tried to do, what Berg tried to do, was he tried to make Schoenberg's systems of atonality more accessible. although when you listen to the first piece that we will cover, you may be slightly disturbed from it because it's a rather jarring scene. Although atonal music's whole sense of it is being free, this piece, this opera, is very clearly structured. It's structured in three acts, the first of which is based on a Baroque suite. The second is based on a five movement symphony. And the final act is based on a set of inventions. And inventions is where you take a specific thing, like a rhythm, a melody, or even a single note to base your whole composition on. What we're going to have a look at is one of these, which is the invention on a note. What we're going to have a look at is the murder scene from Wozzeck. There is something that is extremely clever about this whole scene, which is that through it, there is a recurring note, B. And whenever you hear that note, it's Wozzeck thinking of committing murder. What we will do is that we'll listen to the first minute of this, and then I'll pause and just play you a B, because from that point onwards, the B comes and goes. You won't be able to hear or notice that B immediately or even at all, but just rest assured that it is there, and it's the way that Berg composes the whole scene. It does occur, just to give you some pointers, it does occur at some specific points, like when the stage turns red in the moonlight, when Marie, Wozzeck's lover, is killed, that's the final note that she sings, and also in the postlude after the whole scene where Wozzeck runs off. So let's see if you can cling on to that thought of the bee representing the murder. You might have noticed there is that the violin is going, which is the B that we hear throughout this scene. I'm just going to take it back and we'll have another listen and then go on.
Noch dauern wir.
Ich war fort!
Fürst dich, Marie, und bist doch frau und gut und treu. Das wenn ich dich brauche.
The music and the theme is far from pleasant to listen to. That's exactly the point. It's expressing perfectly as to how to feel that scene. And so that is the whole point of Berg composing this music in the way that he does. That's quite an extreme example of what atonality can be used to do. But it can also be used in a completely other way. Berg was much better at creating music that was atonal, but also really rather pleasant to listen to. His violin concerto is a piece that I discovered fairly recently, and it begins with the violin soloists imitating tuning its strings, which naturally is going to sound pleasant to listen to with it based on tonality. Throughout the movement, you would hear Viennese waltzes, folk songs, and there's even a Bach cantata quote. The Bach cantata that is used uses the text, "Es ist genug," it is enough, which is significant because it's dedicated to the daughter of a close friend, Alma Mahler, and her daughter dies at the age of 18. So Berg dedicated this piece to her. So you'll notice it's very different. It's rather pleasant and enjoyable to listen to.
Thank you.
hope you'll agree that's rather a change to what we've listened to throughout this evening. We're going to finish very briefly with the final composer from what is known as the Second Viennese School. Anton Webern was another student of Arnold Schoenberg's. His music is very interesting because it's very short, it's very compact, and what it requires is very concentrated listening. A good choice actually to finish on, maybe not the best in fact. What Webern did, which was rather interesting, was that he thought that he should compose only everything that is necessary. Now what that means is that some of his pieces that he writes are so short because once they've used all of the 12 tones, he feels as though, well, the piece is done. I think we can finish there. Both of these pieces are a case example of that. And the second piece that we will listen to, the three little pieces for cello third movement, is only 11 bars long, but it's so well structured that someone actually analyzed it to have an exposition, development, and recapitulation. What does that mean? It's the structure for a first movement of a symphony that Mozart would have written in 7 minutes and Mahler would have written in 20. So it's short, compact music. You blink and it's gone. So if you ever hear a very short, strange piece of music, it may be Webern, or it may at least be inspired by Webern. So to finish, although Schoenberg is not often performed, you'll hopefully have realized from this evening that he had a huge, heavy influence on the 20th century and the music that came from it. Although his systems are extremely complex, do bear in mind that whenever you are listening to a piece of music, that they're not meant to be recognized. You just have to realize that they are there and they are being used rather than just a lot of random notes being played. There's methods to the madness, and that's what I hope you'll take from this evening. Do bear in mind that the bottom quote is very important that I've written here, which is that Schoenberg taught his pupils to learn the method, but then to compose freely. So it's that balance of lots of freedom, but also making sure that your music makes sense, which I hope you'll appreciate a little bit more. I always find it helpful at the end of things to give you, if you want to listen to any more music that you've enjoyed from this evening, there's a few suggestions for you here on the screen now. The Schoenberg tonal works that I've written, Verklechte Nacht, Guerra Lieder, Pelléas and Mélisande are actually tonal pieces of music, pieces that you will hopefully like because they are set within a key. Then also the Passacaglia by Webern is something really quite extraordinary that's at the bottom of the screen. So I'll just leave those up just to say thank you all very much for coming along for this evening. And I hope what this will do is it will open up the door for you in terms of if you ever hear a piece that sounds completely inaccessible, it will just hopefully give you some idea as to what the composer's done. So thank you all very much.